If the combined covalent volume of both the ovaries is less than 5 ml, even though there is a good follicle, and you think it's unexplained infertility, in fact, it's a poor ovarian response, and we are only looking at the follicle but not the ovary. If we have done the volume for the patient in the first place itself, you must have picked it up. Or if we are not doing an ultrasound, we should ask the radiologist to report it as volume. A volume on the right ovary, a volume on the left ovary. It doesn't take much time for them, much time for us. But we will be able to perceive on the mind the real value of testing. The second aspect is, we should ask is, in the first visit or subsequent visit, what is wrong in counting follicles? It takes 2 minutes and it gives a lot of information, but we are worried about looking at only 2 things. Whether the follicle has reached 18 millimeters or 16 millimeters, whether the endometrium has crossed 8 millimeters, and whether we can be ready to give a HCG injection and nothing more. But we can find much more information that look at other follicles. Is this a woman of lower ovarian volume whom we are managing and developing perfect monofollicular development? Or is it a multifollicular developed woman where there can be an androgen excess and then developing a single dominant follicle? These are 2 different groups and their prognosis is drastically different. That information we never write, we never understand, and we never use it in a clinical situation. And that we see day in and day out. Here, ultimately, this is a reproductive system in which it has given a 15% chance of conception per cycle. That 15% chance of conception per cycle holds good only for 2 years, not forever, for life for them. After 24 months, the chance per conception per cycle drops down to 55%. And after 100 months, it drops down to close to zero. So here, looking at number of months of cohabitation is equally important. Looking at the other parameters is also important. One thing always remember is, whatever you are trying in assisted reproduction, you are bringing the 15% which has fallen to 5% back to 15%, and you are not doing nothing great more than that. Or you are using superovulation and bringing the 15% temporarily for 1 month or 30%. So when you look at the ovary, you should look at what is the basal conception rate of this couple. If she has only one factor, the pregnancy rates are different. If she has 2 factors, it will be different. If she has 10 factors, it will be different. And did we document all those factors, then we look at it. Most of the time, the commonest conversation I hear from my peers or my juniors is, the follicle is beautiful, the endometrium is beautiful, I did an IUI, I told the patient to conceive. She didn't conceive. What should I do? There, she only looked at the follicle and the endometrium, but did not look at the ovarian volume, did not look at how many follicles else were there, and that person may not have looked at anything to do with the myometrium and the uterine volume. Just looked at the thing. And the third thing is the husband obese? Is the husband healthy? Is the sperm morphology normal? We don't look at it. So I thought I'll take one small passage to count the follicle. because one small facet it will make a lot of difference for many people. It helped me in my own career. From the time I started writing Ovaid volume, then I realized I was missing many women with lower Ovaid volume, thinking they are normal, and then treating them as unexplained infertility. Because I did the AMH or FSH a couple of years before, and I didn't bother to check it. And when you could look at the file, you say normal, 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 but not realize in between things have changed. That's the rule of learning. In these follicles, some of them will turn into oocytes, into babies. And unless we know how to count them, how can we know what we are going to get? The other area is where we have a lot of confusion is what is ovarian reserves, what is poor ovarian reserves, what is ample follicle count, functional ovarian reserves, and follicle number per ovary. These are classical definitions. I have taken most of them from the Wikipedia, which are relevant. And the ovarian reserve tells the thing. A functional reserve tells it in that particular cycle. An ample follicle tells us the quantity of recruitable follicles. And the functional number per ovary tells us if she has a single ovary and you have 12 follicles, her risk factor for OHS is high. So it's a combination of these events which you should look at when you describe your notes. The ovarian reserves, if you are speaking about ovarian reserves, then you should try whether your ample follicle count and your AMH is correlating. If it's not correlating, either you are wrong or the AMH report is wrong. Then go back and look at ovarian volume. If it's correlating with AHC, then the AMH report is wrong. Most of the time we blindly depend on one report and plan treatment. We have to do cross matching, which is already there, only we have to use that information in a better way. In this, I have divided into three components: the physician component, the patient component, and the technology component. We monitor the follicle, and everybody is aware of it. But what we don't know is the follicular growth of this cycle starts almost 120 days before, and not all those follicles from 120 days before we are able to count it. We are only able to count or see the last 30 days of the follicles. The last 30 days of the follicles after they reach the 2 millimeter sizes. So in the ovarian reserve, this concept of recruiting in that particular cycle is also important. It also tells us in future how much it will give. It's like, it does not mean somebody with low ovarian reserves do not conceive. It only says they have so much of reserve. It's just like when you look at petroleum barrels, they say the oil reserves are so much. That's they're speaking about tomorrow, not today. Oil reserves, they say, extend for so many years. So, but it does not say today. It tells us the tomorrow status and it tells us the time to conception concept. Second thing is how efficient the system is. The other thing is there are 8 classes of follicles which have been described almost 70 to 80 years ago, but only now ultrasound is able to pick up them with a better resolution. Earlier, it was only the histopathology that was picking up, and now ultrasound is able to pick up close to 2 millimeters some of the high-end machines, so that the definitions of polycystic ovary is getting changed. The number of follicles that will be there in each ovary to say a polycystic ovary has been revised in 2018 at ESHRE. 10 years back it was 10 for each follicle. Then they moved to 15 or so. Now they're moving to closer to 30 or so exactly, I don't remember, but that was released at the European Society conference. That is because the problem did not change. The tools we have become more refined. This is a chart wherein it shows what was known for many years. Now some of them from the class 5 or class 4 were able to pick it up from the ultrasound. So when you're able to pick up the ultrasound, the class 4 to class 8 follicles and count them, it tells us the reproductive potential of the woman for the next couple of years to help you to plan it. The class 1 to 4, the sensitive the cutting machine is not adequate. So I kept a side image where you could pick up even the 2 millimeters follicles, which is a collaborative work. I worked with Samsung to develop applications for functional ovarian reserves in relation to the actual reserves, so that in future we have tools where you acquire the image. One of the most important things is antral follicle count. If you are seeing a patient every year, AMH declines by 0.4 and the number of antral follicles will change by 1 to 2 follicles per year. What is antral follicle count last year will not be the same antral follicle count 2 years. If you are seeing a patient after 1 year, you are supposed to do an antral follicle count and know the status and document it so that you know that this is the status of the thing. Most of the time we look at the first page report where we saw them first and think results are good. In between they were joined many places, came back after 3 years. So things can change. When it comes to women, we get confused between these three things: ALC, age and AMH. Always remember, age reflects quality. AFC and AMH reflects number. A 40 years woman with a good AFC and a good AMH does not say she has perfect quality. A 10 usage in a 40 years woman is different from a 5 usage in a 30 years woman. The other thing is, we get confused between AF antifollicle count and anti-mullerian hormone. Start sticking to one parameter so that we don't get confused by ourselves, because the inter-observability between the lab and the clinicians are so much. So in a personal practice, I depend on only one parameter so that I don't make mistakes. So for legality purpose, I get the other information. So for practical purpose, I depend on AFC and then look at whether it's correlating or not. If it is not correlating, you can ask how do I find which is the true thing. Whenever there is an anti-mullerian hormone is low, if you look for serum fasting testosterone in the woman, it will be low. It's an indirect indicator, but not a foolproof indicator, only to validate for yourself. So these two charts show antral follicle count as they decline per year, but use only one of these charts. For your dosage requirement, always use the age of the woman, the body mass index of the woman, either the antral follicle count or AMH to start your starting dose of your gonadotropin or clomiphene citrate. But don't use AMH and AFC so that you get confused in the process. Maybe in a couple of years when we get more better refinement and more better algorithms correlating that, then you can use both. So that's the reason when you look at Poseidon concept, they say AFC less than 5 or AMH less than 1.3 or so. But they didn't say combination of these things should be like this. So my telephone message for any ultrasound you are doing is always look at what's the age of the patient you are looking at and then use AFC or AMH, whichever you find comfortable in your setting. But a caveat is, I am not saying AMH or AFC can't be done together. But in the current situation, stick to one so that you have clarity. Because the next area which I would like to address is, why should we all form follicles? The first thing is telling how much of response you get when we plan a stimulation protocol, either inductional ovulation, total ovulation, or IERO. If you understimulate, you get 2x. If you overstimulate, you land in problems. So you should know how many you are getting. Depending on that, you can choose your protocol. And if you have 4 or 5 oocytes, then you can't expect 10 oocytes there. So that will help you to tell how many oocytes you are going to get. If you are not able to tell how many oocytes you are going to get, our assessment is wrong. Because it is indirectly related to the ovarian results. The third thing is, when you look at this chart, the couple is a Louis Brown with her parents, and she was born in 1978. But one thing is, in these 40 years, the media has changed, the drugs have changed, the culture systems have changed, the diagnostics have changed, but counting of follicles did not improve. Monitoring a stimulation cycle during the 10 days has not undergone any progress because they did not pay much attention there. And then we look at all the studies saying this is better, that is better. So in this group, you see, when the ampule follicles are 5, depending on the age on the right side, when you see that thing.
You are seeing in this group of 5 ampule follicles, depending on the age, again your pregnancy rate depends. So when it comes to 6 to 11, and similarly, that makes a lot of difference. If we are not concentrating on that,
then we are obviously missing acute information. AFC has a relation to
AFC number has a relation in terms of age at 38, at 34, and less than 34. So unless we have this information every time you look at the scan
and then correlate the age and the AFC, then you know what is the chance. Sometimes the patient will ask, "Doctor, you said I'll get pregnant. Why didn't I get pregnant?" We cut a sorry test there. I did it many times. Because at that time, nobody told me, I had to use this information to tell the patient. The other area where you can use the counting follicles is, if you have a certain number of follicles and have an endometrioma, to do or not to do a surgery. The third area is, if you have less anti-follicles and you're doing a salpingectomy for a doubtful hydrosalpinge, you might reduce the follicles. The third area is in the area of chemotherapy. In the area of chemotherapy, you count the anti-follicles, with time they decrease. Then you can tell the patient that you have to go for oocyte preservation. And that preservation, anti-follicle count will also tell whether that lady staged one or two cancers of different types, how much time it will need for you to freeze the oocytes. You have to tell that information because the oncologist will decide whether he has that time to wait before he starts the chemotherapy. So the role of this information is, in non-ovarian cancers, when they're starting chemotherapy, if they have anti-follicle count of 6 and 7 and they come for you for oocyte freezing, you should be able to tell them, I need 3 months or 4 months of time to preserve it. Because you have to preserve 25 oocytes before you say they're adequate. The other area is, somebody at 35 has a promotion, does not know, want to marry or pursue a career, or the wants to know what are the chance of pregnancy, then your antral follicle count will tell you this is where we stand. And one important thing is, if the ovarian reserves come low, AMH comes 0.3, and you see 2-3 follicles are there, don't tell the woman she's going to get menopause in 6 months. She can take as long as 3 to 4 years before she attains menopause. That's a very, very important statement. Because when you see an AMH of 0.2, and then on the scan you see small follicles 2 or 3, then you're saying your chance are absent. That statement is 2.99%. Then she will ask me, when will I get a menopause? You might say 6 months. But the reality is she can take 3 years to 4 years. So when you're telling the predictor of menopause, and somebody's chances, you're saying they're bad and they want to abandon treatment. And after 6 months, if she does not get a menopause, she thinks she failed. So don't tell a woman that you're going to get menopause in 6 months or 1 year if you see follicles in the ovary. She can take as long as 3 to 4 years. She may not be reproductively capable, but she'll have menstrual cycles. The other new information that is coming in is, women with lower ovarian reserve, lower antral follicle count, a new test is coming in where they're trying to incorporate a triple screen value to this woman, and they're finding a higher risk of aneuploidy. Earlier it was thought that it was applicable only for older women. Now, a paper that was published a year ago has said there might be a role not for every woman, but some markers, which they're doing it in the first trimester of pregnancy. The reason they're doing it in the first trimester of pregnancy is there, if the markers come positive, they terminate the pregnancy, confirm it with non-invasive DNA, cDNA or CVS, and terminate the pregnancy early so that she will have time to plan a pregnancy. Otherwise, if a problem is diagnosed at 20 weeks, a pregnancy is terminated, she loses 1 year of time and she doesn't have results. These are normal things which we all of us do it. Then the technology side, when it comes to that, you'll be able to measure 2 millimeter follicles, but most of the people accept 6 millimeters and above to be measured as anti-follicle count. The most important thing is, if a radiologist is reporting an anti-follicle count of 6 or 8, always check, or before you send it to the radiologist, look at whether he's using a high frequency transducer or a low frequency transducer, because that also makes a difference in pickup of your oocytes. And anti-follicle count assessment should never be done through abdominal scan, because the margin of error is huge. Lot of times that is done. Because anti-follicle count, you're correlating to tell how much time she has an indirect assessment of ovary. So it should be done by transfusion or ultrasound. And it should be a better quality machine, not 10-year-old machine where the resolutions are suboptimal. And the frequency should be 7 megahertz and higher to do a transfusion ultrasound, to do a reasonably good pickup of anti-follicle count. That is very, very important. The standardization should be done. You can done any time, but start with early follicular phase. See that the woman is not on the oral contraceptive pill. Count from one margin to another and use a high frequency probe, and don't use an abdominal ultrasound to count the antral follicle count. That's the basic standardization you should do for counting follicles. How to estimate the follicle number? There are many ways. One is the 2D ultrasound, the second is the 3D ultrasound. The current technology wants to have some of the features of the 4D ultrasound. So most important thing is read the manual completely. We use only 5% of the machine's capability, nothing more than that. You should be able to use 50% of the capability machine. Here is the current reading machine. You can acquire the volume and then do the word processing and the volume. In future, in 5 years, with the aid of artificial intelligence, X-rays will not be seen by radiologists. Only the abnormal X-rays will be seen by radiologists. Normal CT may not be seen by radiologists. Only abnormal CT will be seen by radiologists because of the artificial intelligence. The second thing you can look at is here, with time, sometimes in the next 10 years, these machines will disappear, only the probe will be there. They'll be connected to the cloud, because once quantum computing comes in, it has enormous power, so that the cloud will do the rest of the things. Already most of the companies are working on that. So here is basically a manipulation of the data where I'm showing the interior of the cavity. That means somebody acquires the volume and sends it, and then you do the processing and look for information you want it in that particular situation. It's called volume acquisition. Here you can also make it sections like a CT scan and look it into individual small pieces, which you can use it for the ultrasound volume assessment and also look for small follicles in multiple planes. Whatever the computer graphics can do, ultrasound machines can do to manipulate the data and give you information. Therein you can look at the data and look at these problems and where exactly this problem is there. If you wanted to cut it here, you can cut it here, which I'll be showing in the next screenshot. Where I'm using the cursor to cut it here, and if you show me that problem there, so that you are able to assess the uterus in a much deeper plane, and the same applies to the uterus. Here I have cut the uterus and then trying to look at it for small pathology. Till now, uterus and sperm were never given proper attention. Uterus we looked at only at the endometrium. So as we move this here, we are looking at inside. When you are looking at inside, it tells you the pathology where it is. So my request to every person is learn ultrasound. Then only you'll have an edge against others. If you are not learning ultrasound, what happens is you are depending on somebody to interpret the data, and you are making your decisions based on their interpretation, not your interpretation. Ultrasound is not difficult, but it involves a break of career of at least a year or 6 months. But that plays a large role. Here, when you look at a follicle, I'm seeing a follicle. If I want to know whether this is there, I can move it anywhere. And then I can also invert it to see the dimensions. Otherwise, in a normal thing, somebody will say two follicles, somebody will say four follicles. But when you invert it and then look at it, you see everything. And this, once you acquire it, that volume data will be there. The other thing is, you can also look at if it is static in the particular plane, and then look at it. So learning about, there are a lot of online videos, both from Samsung and GE, where have a look at them to understand the technology, so that when you are ready. So here I am moving it so that I know that I counted the follicles properly. Which technique to use? There are different techniques. But what is practical is, here I am showing you a single loop of how you can use a normal 2D ultrasound. Take a semi loop. After you do a semi loop, freeze the loop, then slowly rotate the trackball and count the follicles. That is as efficient as a 3D ultrasound. Most of the time, we don't take a semi loop. And if you take a semi loop, a short film again, you are able to count the number of follicles and then say this is the antral follicle count. Then move the trackball slowly so that you look frame by frame and then count the antral follicle. It is much more efficient than AMH. So using semi loop function, the other thing is, in advanced machines, what happens is you can slice the ovary. When you look at it here, you have When you look at it here, you have the diameters at which it was cut. 2 millimeter sections are taken. So you see, as it's like a multiplane CG section, then you count the number of follicles, which is similar to the semi loop, but much faster because we acquired a higher technology. Similarly, in the multiplanar view, the third is, this is only a graphical glorification of 5D follicles for the Sony AVC, which will help you to count follicles or count the measurements. But first thing is, forget about measurements. Start counting the follicles properly. Start using ovarian volume as a measurement, which will help you. These are all gimmicks which the company will provide by inverting the image. But one thing is, anti-mullerian hormone and anti-follicular count demonstrate the most favorable analytical performance issues, but we can choose one of them which we can like. One of the things which we are working was monitoring the blood flows of each individual follicle, so that you know that that follicle will have a utilized recite. And that technology is already available. It's only a question of time before that refinement comes in. But first of all, is start counting the follicles, start measuring the ovarian volume. That's a basic step which has helped me tremendously in my career. So the proper counting of follicles aid in better diagnosis, better starting dose, will not miss low ovarian results, and is less likely to have ovarian hyperstimulation. That's my carry-home message. And this is, we have a Buddhist group in Vizag. We also have a big company called Brandix. It employs the largest women workforce in a single unit in India, which is based in Vizag. Thank you, Sri Lanka. So if there are no questions, then it's fine. Thank you very much, sir.
thank you for the excellent presentations made by Dr. R. Raju and Pavitra and our Dr. Shami Dhuntubura. Now we have come to the end of the sessions, and are there any questions that you like to ask from the or any clarifications? I think overall, I think everything has been covered, so everything is very clear, so there are probably any more questions for you to ask from the expert panel? Or they have understood everything. Thank you. So I must take this opportunity to thank the Merck and the local agent Bowers and the energetic team from Bowers, Damien, Peter, who was always very much supportive of this educational program and giving all the positive support. Thank you very much. I think refreshments and lunch is available for you. Thank you.